Hi, Jody. It's one tick.
I was going to say, hi, are you there?
I better move the camera. Always moves the camera. It's right in the way of the screen. I think that's why. And he was doing origami how-to videos there earlier.
Wow, well, that's different.
Yeah, he used to do quite a lot of origami. And he got away from it a little bit, but now he's getting back into it, I guess.
Well, there you go. Keep those interests going, eh?
Yeah, except that I'm pretty sure it's because he learned how to make a ninja star with origami a while ago, right? Years ago. So he's bought these, you know, those tinfoil cookie trays you can get at the dollar store?
Oh my gosh, yeah.
He's bought a bunch of those, and he's trying to do the ninja stars with those.
Oh my gosh. So you got to watch out for those then.
Yeah, I'd say, yeah, fly around. We'll see. Hi, Lane.
Hi, Dan.
How you doing?
Not too bad. How are you doing?
Oh, pretty good, pretty good. Moving some stuff into the new house today, which is exciting. Just okay. You know, trying to uncover my fridge, stove, washer, and dryer so they can install it. And so rather than take the stuff out to, you know, take the fridge, stove, and everything out, put it back in, I just take it right over to the other house, put it in the basement. So, and I had the boy doing it today with me. He did it all day. It was great. And he pushed the big trailer with me and everything. Very, very, very pleased about that.
There you go.
Then we have a new face. Matthew, how you doing?
Good. How are you?
I'm doing good. Yeah. And you're brand new right out of the box. Is that right?
Brand new.
Right on. So tonight you're going to be just kind of sitting there listening a little bit. I think it'll be really good for you because we're going to talk a lot about, you know, the machinations of the fiddle, and I'll talk about it again with these guys because it's always good to hear that stuff again, and then you'll see what a few things that we'll try attempting. All right.
Hey, am I on there, Dan?
Hey, Bill. Yes, your camera's not on, but you are on.
What isn't on?
Your camera.
Oh, the camera. I don't know. Like, it didn't work on my other computer, so this is my iPad. It's actually Grace's iPad, but I don't know.
Okay, so you should be able to turn your video on. If you look on the bottom of your Zoom window, Bill, there's a camera icon, and there's probably a slash through it right now. So you want to click that camera icon, and it'll turn your camera on.
I'm on an iPad, and it's on the top of your screen, top right corner.
Top right corner of the screen there, Bill.
Top right corner, there's just a little red dot.
Yeah. Can you swipe down? Swipe it down. There'd be record on the left.
Okay. All kinds of things came down.
Yeah, so you should see the little microphone that'll have a line through it, and then you'll want to change that. Tap on that so that it turns, on the video. There's a little camera. Like,
yeah.
Look, little camera. Looks like a little video camera.
Yeah.
And, no, I don't see that.
Okay.
I see a little bell and a flashlight, and I see
a bell.
A bell and a flashlight.
Oh, wait a minute. No, wait. Oh, I got a bunch of stuff up here.
Yeah.
It says start video.
Oh, there you go.
There you go. That's it. Got it.
Good man yourself. Cool. Now we got it. So we got a few brand new guy here, Matthew. And between all of us, we're going to have to tell him all about playing the fiddle. Okay? All about it. Now, these guys have been at it for a little while there, Matthew. They've been at it for probably a good few years anyway. And so they're a little bit further along, but we're going to try our best to indoctrinate you and get you into this whole playing the fiddle thing. Now, I saw you were tuning there. So are you managing to get your fiddle in tune?
I think so. I've kind of figured it out through the just fiddling with the fine tuners and everything.
Cool. Do you want me to play your strings for me so I can hear them? Close enough for Irish. That's what they say. Very good. Okay, and not too bad with playing the strings there. So, and since you already have a handle on that, I can see that you know you've discovered how to hold the violin, right? And it looks pretty good. Looks pretty good the way you're doing it there. But I'll just reiterate for everybody here as well, because it's always good to remind yourself, to hold the violin, you put it up on your left shoulder, and then you turn your head slightly so you can see the scroll, and then you put the corner of your jaw, this part here, into the chin rest, this part here, into the chin rest, and lean it in like that. And then, oh, that's perfect, Matthew. You got it perfect there. And it means you don't need your hand, right? You can use your hand to play rather than to hold it. Very good. Very good. And then with the bow hold, let me see your bow hold there, Matthew. For now, that's really perfect. That's great. The only difference I would make, because you have the tips of your fingers on the bow, you might also want to put the tip of your thumb under the frog for now. They call that the beginner hold. See that? And because what happens is, as you learn how to hold the bow and you need to do more things with it, your thumb goes up under here and your fingers actually start to come down around the stick like that. See that? But usually when we start off, we just start off with the very tips of the fingers like this. Okay? And see how that works for you. The way you were holding it looked really well as well. But that's very good. That's really good. Now, bowing the strings, and this is just a good reminder for all you guys. Bowing the strings, we put the bow between the bridge of the fingerboard, okay, and we pull the bow in, we hope, a straight line between the bridge and the fingerboard all the way to the end. And so when I'm finished, my down bow, my arm is kind of straight out in front of me, and my back. Yeah, that's good, Bill. See that? And then the up bow is the same. You gotta kind of pull the bow up like this in a straight line, and try to lead with your wrist, okay? Yeah. Now, one of the first things I always get people to do, and we're gonna do it here, guys, as a reminder, is we're gonna do a down bow and then an up bow on each string, starting on the G, okay? And then when we get finished playing the E string, we're gonna go and go the other way, okay? So let's give it a try. Now, Matthew, you can either try to watch while I demonstrate, and we're all going to give this a try. Okay, ready? Oh, I got to mute everybody. Almost forgot. There we go. Okay. Here we go. Ready? Down bow. D. Up bow. You kind of have a knack for it already. You're moving the bow straight and you're managing to keep your elbow stationary. I don't see it wandering all over the place. So that means that you're able to move the bow straight. Very, very good. Let's do it again. Same thing except better. Starting on the G string. Ready, go. Very good. How's that feeling for everybody? You getting down to the end of your bow nice? All the way to the end, straight line. Nice flexible wrist there. Paint the fence, Mr. Miyagi. Very good. Okay, now let's try some of the old, what do you call it there? The up-up. So this here. Where we stop the bow halfway. So we do a down bow. And then we do an up bow. Yep, Bill's got it. Stop in the middle. Let's do that. We'll do it on each string, same like we just did. Ready, go. Down. Up. Up. D. Up. Up. Hey. I still have that slick spot on my bow where I touched my friend Shane's lemon slice on the side of his drink there at Noonan's, I don't know, it was about a month ago, something like that. And I didn't mean to, but I was picking up my bow and it just happened to touch the lemon and knock it into his drink. And ever since then, I got this little slick spot on my bow. I can't seem to keep rosin on it. And every once in a while, I'm going along and I hear it loses sound for a second. And I know I got to put the rosin on again. And it's two bags. I just got it rehaired. So it's kind of a pain. I got to keep re-rosining it. This is rosin, Matthew, if you didn't already know that. It's dried tree sap mixed with linseed oil and several other things. Everybody's got their own secret formula, but it's basically what makes the sound on your fiddle, like between the string and the bow. It's the rosin that makes the sound, because the rosin creates a slip grip cycle on the string where it hooks it and it lets it go over and over to make the sound. And it's the rosin that does that from the stickiness. Okay. So now let's try that down, up, up thing again, but we're going to move the bow quicker this time. It's going to be more like this. Like that. Oh, that's nice, fresh rosin. Did a lot of playing to yesterday. So, you know, you wear it off. Okay, let's do it a little faster. I'll count you in. A one, two, three, go. Oh, whoops, I did two. Let's do it again, one on each string. Ready, two, three, G. Looking good. You're doing the right thing there, Matthew. Very good. Now let's try some other beginner things. All right. Let's try a little bit of this. Little circles in front of your nose with the bow to make little momentary notes. And so let's do this. Let's do four on each string, starting on the G string. So four little bumps and then move on to the next string. Okay. A one, two, three, go. Yeah, looking good. Let's do it again. Same thing. A one, two, three, go. That's good. Okay, now I gotta tune my fiddle because it's suddenly dropped. My E string is suddenly dropped. Okay, cool. That's great. Now, how's everybody doing with your little momentary notes? Are they nice? Are they clean? Are you having any trouble? Is the boat crashing? Maybe sometimes, but hopefully not too bad. Pretty good. Okay. Matthew, how are you getting along so far? How did all that go?
Well, I think I've been toying around with it with some online videos for a week or so. So I think I've got an okay sound.
Oh, good. That's great. Now, have you done a scale yet?
I've tried to do a scale and some, you know, really basic versions of tunes that I know in my head. And I find it very hard to play very in tune, but
yes.
I'm fairly comfortable playing slightly not in tune.
That's great. You wouldn't believe how many people are comfortable playing slightly not in tune. There's a lot of people, but that's really good. Now, tell me some of the tunes that you know in your head, like what, for instance?
So first one that I just kind of eared out was Twinkle Twinkle. It's pretty natural on a violin. And then the Skyboat song, very rudimentary version of it. And Auld Lang Syne was the other one that I kind of figured out while I was trying to figure that one out.
Wow, that's excellent. Very good. Good start. Very good. Okay, so we're going to mess around with scales now. So we're going to do what I find to be the most basic scale on the fiddle, which is the G major scale. So that has this shape of your, this is first position where there's a gap between the first and second finger. And so that's going to be first position for the G string and the D string. And then for the A string and the E string, we move the second finger to be close to the first finger. You see how that works there? Now I'll demonstrate it. These guys have done it 1,000 times, but it always helps to see it again. So here's what it looks like. The top of the scale. You see how that works? So let's all try that, and Matthew can give it a try and see if he can do his best. Nice and slow. A ready, two, three, go. G today. How's G? Is it happy G? That's great. And how is yours, Matthew?
There was a little bit of hunting, but I got it.
Do you understand what I mean by the second finger moving for the upper strings?
Yeah, once I heard I was out, I kind of shifted to it. I think I've got to just kind of memorize where everything is.
Yeah, and this is the first position we start off with, because you can get three keys with this gap between one and two. See that? So with this exact position, you can get G major, D major, and A major. See how that works there? Just starting on each string with the same finger position. That does not change. So that's why we start off with those, and that's why they call those the fiddle keys. And that's why everything, all fiddle music is in G, D, and A, and their relative minors. See what I mean? So that's what we start off with, is the first position. But then to get the second octave of G, you got to move that second finger down close to the first finger. That's the only change that you make. Okay, let's do it again so Matthew can practice that. And then we're going to try an arpeggio. Okay, nice scale. Ready, two, three, go. Scale in two octaves. Now, the arpeggio. So I'm going to demonstrate it just because I don't know if Matthew's ever done it before, but we got open two and then open. 3-1-3. And then the top note G, which is E2. And then we come back down 2, A3, A1. D3, open D, G2, and then open G. See how that works there? That's called an arpeggio. And if you played all those notes together at the same time, it would make a G major chord. Okay? But we can't do that because can only play two strings at a time. So we split it up and play it like that. So let's try the G major arpeggio for Matthew's sake here. And I'm going to call out the numbers as we do it. Okay? So we got open G and then 2. Ready, go. Open. 2. Open D. D3. A1. A3. E2, back to the A3, A1, D3, open D, G2, open G. Okay, and arpeggios always have the same finger combination pattern. So it's either even number fingers for one octave and odd number fingers for the other, or the other way around. So in this case, the lower octave is open to open. So that's the even number fingers. Okay. And then for the next octave, it's the odd number fingers, 3-1-3. See that? And then when you go to the top, it's the 2 again, and then it would be the 4. And then if you had another string, it would be the open. See what I mean? So that's how we do that. That's how the arpeggios always work. Let's do it again. Open G and then 2. Open 2, open 3-1-3. Okay, here we go. Open G. Ready, go. 2. E2, A3, A1, D3, open D. G2. And open G. All right, now that looked like it went pretty well. Now, let's pick up the pace and put Matthew through a little bit of trial by fire. And we're going to do the scale followed by the arpeggio like this. And then, like that. Okay, let's do it. Matthew, put your helmet on. Keep your gun up. One, two, three, go. Feeling? Doing good? Tuners happy? Now, I always say this to be brand new beginners, and I think it's always good to talk about violin intonation is not a perfect science. Nobody ever plays completely in tune. That's why vibrato was invented. So we try to get close as we can all the time. It's target practice, all right? When you first start trying it, you're lucky to get the dart on the same wall as the dartboard. After a while, you get closer and closer so that you up your accuracy. So don't try for perfect. Just try for, you know, as close as you can every time. Okay? It's much better. Now, let's try some double stops. So double stops is where you're playing two strings at the same time. Okay? Sounds like this. Now, before we do that, I'm going to just send Matthew our pattern here. And you can read music already, right?
Very poorly.
Okay, well, it's all right. I got numbers written in here for you. Don't worry about it.
I play guitar, so we usually avoid sheet music at all costs.
I understand. Well, you know, the thing is about violin, is that the sheet music, like reading music on the violin, kind of goes hand in hand with playing the violin, because the music staff is a violin, and as you put your fingers down, the dots go up, and as you take your fingers off, the dots go down. It's very intuitive, and so if you can do it at the same time, it's a real booster. You know, it's a real bonus. Anyway, let me just send you this. Okay, this is it. Yes. Okay. Okay. So I just sent you what this looks like, what we're about to do there, Matthew. And you'll see what it looks like. You'll see what the two notes together look like. And me and the other guys here are going to do it to demonstrate for you, okay? G major double stops, everybody. We'll do two bows per set of double stops. So it's going to sound like this. Let's do it. A one, two, three, go! Thank you. a good set of double stops for me. You know, we were talking, I was at a rehearsal last night with a band called Poor Angus, and we're playing a Festival of the Sound on Monday. I don't know if any of you guys have ever been to Festival of the Sound, but it's up in Parry Sound, and it's gorgeous. And the first thing they do is a boat cruise. So it's a big boat, and they take you right through Parry Sound and through around some of the islands and stuff, and the band plays on the boat. The rest of the festival is a classical music festival, but we're playing on the boat cruise, and we got together, and it's kind of a band of hired guns, because like I'm in the band and I'm a hired gun. My friend DJ, who plays the bass in the band, is also a hired gun, and I run into him at many gigs that I play. There's DJ playing the bass. The other guy, Joel, is a hired gun out in Hamilton, a singer and rhythm guitar player. Very in demand. He's, you know, never knows who he's going to play with. And we were talking about playing covers of popular songs. And there's so many artists that get really tired of playing covers of popular songs, like Whiskey in the Jar or Sonny's Dream or The Wild Rover or whatever. They get tired of it or whatever. But I don't. And the other guys I was talking to, they also don't, because we're professionals and we're really into it. And so when somebody, I was saying that for Sonny's Dream, I have a set of double stops that I love to do during the song Sonny's Dream underneath the vocals, right? And so my big challenge, I've played that song, I think probably 1,000 times with different singers and bands, and maybe even more. I have yet to play that set of double stops completely in tune from one end to the other. Still haven't done it. So I don't get tired of it. When somebody says, oh, let's do Sonny's Dream, I'm like, oh yes, this time I'm gonna get it. So I don't get tired of it. It's so good to practice. Let's do it once more. Because I think Matthew was just starting to kind of get the hang of it there as we were doing it. So let's give it another go. Okay. Ready, two, three. Everybody feeling? Gonna get it all in tune one day, hopefully. Okay. Very good. Okay, now I was thinking tonight, it'd be nice to go through some of the old stuff that we used to do, such as Matthew was talking about Sky Boat Song. That would be very, very good to do. It's been a while, and I think it's in the right key. Well, it's in D. No, it's in G. Yeah. Okay, so we'll do Sky Boat Song. I'm going to send you the one that we're working with there, Matthew. I'm not sure which one you ran into on the internet, but Sky Boat Song.
I think I played it in D.
Just perfect. Oh, really?
But I think it's the same, but more or less the similar pattern.
It's a similar pattern, but to play in D. So. No, that's an A. So I think you were actually. You mean you started on the D string? That's actually in G. So it starts on the fifth. You know how that is. You're a guitar player. You definitely know how that is. Lots of tunes start on the fifth. I'm going to send you this, but I think you probably have the same as what we're doing. But just to be sure, there you go. Okay. So let's give this a little go here. Sky Boat Song, the old girl. Okay. Can we do verse, chorus, verse? I think. A 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, go. How did everybody get along? Blast from the past, eh? Did it come back to your fingers? It's pretty easy. It's a pretty easy one. Now, how'd you get along with that, Matthew?
I'm following. I think I kind of listened and tried to piece it out from the music. I played it just down a string. Would that be D? Yeah, D.
That would be D, I think, yeah. Yeah, I think that's D, yeah. So that's good. That's good. That works as well. This would be definitely the more common key for it, though. Especially for singer, that's the more in the range that they can sing. Let's do it again, okay? Oh, now I see I have a version with finger numbers written in. Let me send it to you now. That helps a lot when you're first starting off.
With the O on the D and the D1?
Yeah.
That's the one you sent me. You sent me that one.
Oh, good. I sent you that one. Okay, that's great. Okay, let's do it. Here we go. A 1, 2, 3, go, 2, 3. Thank you. righty. Okay, now let's move on. Now, last time we were doing Dirty Old Town. And yeah, it's really easy. I'm not sure if you did it, Julie, but let me just demonstrate it. Sense? Yeah, it's really easy. It's very simple tune, and it starts on the D string, open 3, and 1. Okay, let's go real slow, because I know Julie might not have done it, and I'm not sure about Bill either, and definitely Matthew hasn't done it. So let's go really slow, and I'll try to call out a few numbers as we go. A 1, a 2, a 3, D, 3, A, 1. Another 1, A, D, 3, 1, D, A, 1, 1, 3, D, back to the 3, 1, A, 3, A, 1, E, 3, 4, D, 3, open again. Oh, sorry, 1. And then A1 down the scale. Skip 2. Let's do it again. Open 3. Back to the 3. Very good. A1. Okay, Julia, look good. Look great. Yeah, good. How about you, Matthew? You get the idea with that one?
I listened in while trying to get the fingerings on Skyboat song.
Oh, yeah? How did that go?
It was all right. I kind of would keep up for the first, bar or so of the part that I know well, and then kind of have to drift off and drift back in.
Yeah, that's normal. So just keep at that. Now, what about the Dirty Old Town? I'm sure that's one that you're familiar with, right?
No, I've never heard that one before, actually.
You've never heard Dirty Old Town?
Nope.
Oh, wow. Now, where are you located, by the way?
I'm in Oakville.
You're in Oakville, and you have never heard Dirty Old Town. Wow. Because that's probably the number one most popular song I play at bars in the GTA. And I think I might have played it at the Pipes and Taps with Michael Darcy out in Oakville there when I played out there not long ago. So it's a good, you'd love it. It's a great song. It's very well known. It's the Pogues, the band called the Pogues. They recorded it and it became hugely popular. So since Matthew's just kind of flailing his fingers and trying to figure it out, let's go a little quicker, okay? So let's kind of go do it like kind of... That's more the tempo you would do it for a bunch of drunks on a Saturday night. Okay. A 1, a 2, a 3. Everybody feeling that? You know, the guy, the lead singer from the Pogues, Shane McGowan, everybody knew him for the terrible teeth, you know, the baked bean teeth that he had there, and he was always smoking. And apparently he got new teeth, and now nobody likes him as much because he doesn't look near as much the part as he used to. Now that he's got new chompers. There you go. Anyway, so that's Dirty Old Town. So that's doing good. Everybody's feeling good. That's great. Very good practice. Let's do one more tune song before we move on, just for the benefit of those who have never tried to do stuff like this before. So I think we did we do Wild Rover? Yeah. Familiar with Matthew? No, another new hit for you. No, now this one's a much older song. This is as old as the hills.
I was just gonna say my most of my fiddle tune familiarity comes from bluegrass, so a lot of whiskey before breakfast, that type of tune.
Oh, cool. Well, that's pretty cool. Well, there's a few of those we can get too. Okay, so we're gonna do Wild Rover. And Matthew's going to try desperately to see what the hell's going on with Irish music. And this is one of the hits that the kids like me to sing when we're canoeing. This weekend when we went to the cabin, they did not request that. They requested Whiskey in the Jar. That was the main one we kept singing. And the Ballad of Bridie Murphy. And I don't know if you've ever heard that one, but it's a really hilarious song. And it's a true story about a kamikaze pilot in World War II in the bombing of Pearl Harbor, and he crash-landed on an island that had a convent on it, and one of the nuns, who was tired of being a nun, met him, and they got married and had a kid and lived happily ever after. He defected from the army, she defected from the convent, and that was it. And there's a hilarious song about it called The Ballad of Bridie Murphy. My brother Sean used to sing. Anyway, that's what I was singing all weekend. The kids hiked into our cabin 7.5 kilometers, fully laden with packs on their back, and they only complained a few hundred times. I was quite proud of them. And on the way back, too, they worked their little butts off, and they got us in there and out of there, and we had a fabulous time. It was really good, but that was the first for them. It was almost 4 hours of hiking and canoeing to get to this cabin, so... It was pretty cool. Anyway, Wild Rover. Here we go. A 1, 2, 3, 1, 2. Thank you. All right, now how did that go? Everybody looked like they were doing just fine. Did it come back to your fingers? That's really good. Really, really good. Let's try one more time, okay? And we're going to go a little bit faster. So it's going to be more like this. Let's see if we can do it, okay? Lovely little tune. One, two, three, go! Is screaming out for a double stop. An octave, see that? Beefs it right up to end the tune, okay? Really good idea. And there's a few spots, I'm sure you heard me doing a few double stops in there. And now that you guys have a little bit more skill, especially with double stops, you could go and revisit those old song tunes that we did, or any of them really, and see where you can get in a few. But I can put quite a few in there. This one. They're all ones we've done. Except that one. Stop the whole thing if you want to, which is I find really good for practicing it. You know, you wouldn't might not want to use that much when you play it, but if you can, then you can, right? Anytime you want to, you're going to be able to. So I find it's always good to do that, but it might be fun for you guys to try looking at that and see where those typical ones that we've already learned would apply. Fourths and fifths and octaves and thirds, okay? Anyway, let's move on. So now the last tune we did was a Scottish one. We're going to take a drastic Scottish turn to the barren lands of the Highlands. And we're going to play, what do you call it there? What was it? Leaving Lismore. Scottish music. Now, I'm thinking of a few. Have you tried to do Oh Susanna yet there, Matthew? Oh. Very good one to do. It's on my YouTube channel, Oh Susanna. Have we done Oh Susanna, guys? A long time ago. We'll refresh it. We'll refresh it. It's a really good one. Stephen Foster, you can't beat it, you know. Okay, let's see here. Leaving Lismore. But before that, this will be Matthew's kind of introduction to Scottish music. So Far, Wild Rover, Dirty Old Town, Skyboat Song are all, well, Skyboat Song, kind of both cultures claim Skyboat Song. So I'm not going to kind of tread into that territory. But the other two tunes are definitely Irish. So this is the first Scottish one. Now, let me play it to remind us all how it goes and everything. And then we're going to give it a go together, okay? And Matthew, have I sent you the music for it? No. Okay, let me do that now, and then you can kind of follow along while I'm playing it. Leaving Lismore. PDF. And Lismore. Okay, off it goes to you. And now I'm going to play it so you can follow along. And the fingerings are written into the music. It makes it a little easier to get onto it first. How's everybody doing with it? Pretty good? This is basically an exercise in intonation because the whole thing is very kind of in tune with itself. They call that diatonic. So the word diatonic means that it doesn't involve any notes that are outside of the key of A. Okay? Lots of tunes do. Lots of tunes will have an accidental or two in there, come out of the key for a little bit and go back in. But this one is completely diatonic. So it all ends on the A. Do you notice that? Every part ends on the A to give you the nice kind of final kind of sound for each part. So that's what's good about it. And that's why it's good, commonly used for beginners. Let's do it again. Let's do it a good couple of times. Matthew looked like he was starting to pick away at a couple of notes there just as we were finishing. So let's do it. We'll have him scotchy by no time. Here we go. A 1, 2, 3, 1, 2. Thank you. That's a great tune. I love that tune. It's been so long since I played that tune. Now, how are we all feeling? Does anybody have any questions or queries or complaints or things to point out or revelations or anything like that about the Leaving Lismar? No, it's pretty straightforward too. There's some double stops that I'm putting in there. It's very kind of a no-brainer. Basically, it's the type of tune where you can be playing on the A and the E string for like the whole time if you want. Now, of course, I wouldn't do all that unless I wanted to be a bluegrasser, where they tend to double stop pretty well everything they're doing. And that's one of the distinguishing things with Celtic music, Celtic fiddling, and bluegrass fiddling, is we do a lot less double stops. I know a couple of bluegrassers that have their bridge almost flattened out as they play so many double stops. It's just easier for them. Now, also, I know a lot of Irish people that have a flattened out bridge too, but not quite as drastic. And they say, and it's not a thing in Scotland, it, like all the Scottish players that I know have a regular violin bridge, regular arch on the bridge. And I don't know if you guys know this, but the arch on the bridge is not symmetrical. So you can see it's kind of higher on the G side than on the E side. See that? And that's because it follows the curve of the fingerboard. And if you look at the fingerboard really closely, you'll see that that is also not symmetrical. It's higher on the G side than it is on the E side. Is everybody seeing that now? There's kind of a camphor to it, or whatever they call it there. And so the way that they get the curve on the bridge, when they get a new blank, they put the new blank on there, and it's a very scientific process that I read about in one of the most highly regarded books about making violins that there is, Henry Strobel's book about how to make a violin. And he says that there's a specific Bic pin. It's the white one with the blue end, and you put it on the fingerboard and you run it up to the bridge, and then you slide it across the fingerboard like that, and that makes the perfect line to shape the curve of your bridge. You see that? It's an exact copy of your fingerboard, and this specific Bic pin seems to put it right at the right place, the right height, because it's a specific height as well. Okay, so that's the, and all the Scottish and Cape Breton people that I know have a regular violin shape to their bridge. In Ireland is the first time I ran into this flattened out bridge thing. There's a few people that had it. And then when I was down in the States and I played with bluegrassers, most of them had the flattened out bridge. Now, the Irish guys that I talked to about it, they say it's because it's less work to change strings, which absolutely it is. It would drive me out of my mind, because I'd keep touching those other strings when I didn't want to. And it would be too much. Well, it was. I've tried a couple of them. It drove me nuts. I cannot understand how people play with a bridge like that. But it's a very common thing. Anyway, if there's no questions or anything, let's do it a couple of more times. And then maybe we should resurrect You Are My Sunshine for the bluegrasser in the Zoom room. But first, more Scottish. And a little faster. You don't go much faster than what we were doing, but we'll just put a little bit of a spring in our step. A one, two, three, one, two. Thank you. All right, now Matthew, tell me what you think of leaving Lismar. Do you think you can get your hand around it?
I think I can. I like it. I like the tune. It's a good
tune. Oh, good. That's a great tune. Great old tune. And very common one for beginners to learn in Cape Breton. You know, and it's kind of, there's this book that my friend Sandy McIntyre made a long time ago, and it's near the beginning of the book. So it's a very good one to have under your belt. Any of the ones, I'll send you a link to the book because somebody just digitized it for us. And any of the ones in the first section there are all really good to get. Now, let's see. Let's see about the old You Are My Sunshine. I'm pretty sure I sent music for it at some point. Sunshine. Let's see here. I know I did find it at some point. Maybe it was sent.
I think we learned it by ear. I don't have music for it.
Okay, let me see if I have music for it. You might not have music for it. Maybe we all learned it by ear. Oh, wait. Oh, I did find something for it. Now that's Tell Me Ma. Also a very good tune. Okay, I'm going to send a link to you guys with this You Are My Sunshine music, if you want it, but see if we can get along without it. You are it's good that you were doing Auld Lang Syne there, Matthew. That's a great one. I kind of forgot about that. That's Robbie Burns' special, and it's a great one to do. It's definitely familiar to the ear. Okay, I just sent everybody a link to You Are My Sunshine music. Let me just make sure I know what key you're in. Yeah. Hey. So I'll play it for you just to remind you how it goes. Is that making sense? Start on the A string like that, or well, it starts on the D1 to the A.
What key are we in there, Dan?
A. Does that make sense? This is my number one A double stop. E1 and open A together. This particular tune starts off that way. See that? And then, so that's how you do it. You find these patterns, and that's how you know what key you're in. Now, it starts off on D1 to open A. Okay? Let's go nice and really slow and see if Matthew can get his hand around it. Now, Matthew, can you turn the filter on your video? You got the blurry outy thing, and it means that I can't see your left hand. So can you turn that off so I can see your left hand? Do you know how to do that? There, perfect. Excellent. All right. And let's go slow. No hurry. So it's going to be like 1, 2, 3. Thank you. Okay. Geez, you got a great start on that already, Matthew. You're missing a few notes, but you definitely have the basic structure and the shape of your hand for this tune. Very good. Your ears must be good. So let's try it again. Let's do it like, I don't know, 500 or 600 times and see if Matthew can get the whole thing. And you guys try to keep her in tune. Try to hold the notes out for their full length. And if you can, put the odd wiggle on the odd note. Okay? Let's see if we can do it. 1, 2, 3. How's everybody doing? Hanging in? That's good. How about you, Matthew? You getting in there? Great. Let's speed it up. All right? More like this. Okay? Every time I tap my foot, it's shaking my camera. Makes me feel like a giant or something. I don't know why. Can't wait to get into this little house. Okay, here we go. A little faster. A 1, a 2, a 3. Sunshine, Stephen Foster special for the last 100 and some years. So how's everybody feeling? Everybody feeling good? You get a little fancy stuff in there, hopefully? No? That's okay. Next time we'll do that. Now, let's review one more tune before we're done. It'd be really good for Matthew there, too, because it's kind of Irish music central. And we'll do the Kesh Jig. Okay, so this is a jig. A jig is in 6/8 time. It's a dance. It's meant to be for a step dance or for a social dance. And it's kind of also, I'll play it while these guys are, oh, here, let me send it to you, Matthew, first of all. I have the music for it. And then another one, too, on the same page. There we go. Yeah, there we go. Cast on that. And all of these tunes that we've done so far are on my YouTube channel, Dan McDonald Fiddle Teacher. So you can keep referring back to them. I play them really slow and up to speed. So you can keep kind of referring back and trying to learn them, okay? Now, while these guys are trying to find the Kesh, because it's been ages since we did the Kesh, I'm going to play it for you so you can hear what it sounds like. Oh, why? All that moving today is making me tired. Okay, so I'm going to play it first so everybody remembers how it goes. The Kesh Jig. So it's a jig, so that means jiggity, jiggity, diddly, 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 diddly. That's a jig. You can see it's very simple. All the tunes are the same. We got first phrase. Second phrase. First phrase again. Second phrase with an ending. They're all the same. These tunes are all, bluegrass tunes are very similar, usually the same setup as well. First phrase, second phrase, first phrase again, ending. Now here's the second part. First phrase. Second phrase. Third phrase. Ending. Little tiny bit more complicated. We don't have that repeat of the first phrase like we do in the first part. But anyway, me and the other fiddlers are going to start playing it there, Matthew. You're going to start looking at it and try to figure out how to get your hand around it and make sense of it, and then maybe we'll try it real slow. So first of all, guys, let's try it at a kind of a moderate speed, like let's do it. Okay, I'll count you in. 1, 2, 3, go. Good finish. Love that flourish at the end. It means job well done, usually. So everybody coming back to the cache? Is it coming back okay? That's great. Okay, Matthew, I saw you were trying to figure out a few of those phrases. Did you have any success? Oh, good. Okay, let's go dead slow. All right? Give Matthew a chance to get his hand around the tune. For you guys, it's a chance again to make sure you're playing nicely in tune, up there bright. You can listen to me and make sure you're up there and hold your notes out. Okay, let's do it nice and slow. I'll count you in. Ready to go.
Thank you.
right, and that's the cache. So good to get these things back. Now, when we revisit that next time, we'll see what the people that have been doing it for a little longer. We'll see if we can dress it up a bit. See how the rolls are doing, for instance. And see if we can speed it up a little bit, too, with some get some jig rhythm in there. Okay? Now, Matthew, what did you think? How did you get along kind of trying your best to follow along with that?
I got the first little phrase down and then memorized the rest.
Yep, that's the way to do it. You're really on the right track. Now, I got to tell you, for a person that's just starting off, you got a lot of things going for you already. So the way you're holding the violin seems consistently good. Like, you're not letting that wrist collapse. I haven't seen you let that happen at all. So keep that up, that nice rounded left hand. That's really, really good. Try not to let that wrist collapse, okay? Really good. So most people have a lot of problem with that. So you're off to the races there. Also, you seem to be moving your bow in a really straight line most of the time. Okay? So that's, again, that puts you way further ahead than most people when they start off. So make sure you keep that going. The nice straight bow and the rounded wrist and the spacing of your fingers, and you're going to kind of jump the gun with a lot of this stuff. It's looking really good already. Okay, so I want you to get familiar with this stuff. Next time, we're going to dress it up a bit. We're going to make it a little bit more challenging. And these guys are going to stick some ornaments into it and try to make it into a jig. Okay, I'm going to end off our class a little early tonight because I'm on my own with the kids. And it got all quiet up there. So there is a possibility that they killed each other. So I just have to go and either, you know, clean up the mess or make sure they're okay. Anyway, we'll see you guys next time, and you got a video coming. I'm going to make videos. Tomorrow is video production day, so you got videos coming, all right? Thanks a lot. See you next time.